To this service of worship here at St. Paul's United Church of Christ in Crystal Lake, Illinois. I'm Pastor Greg Lucas. I'm glad you've joined us for this online service of Christian worship. The flowers provided today are from Tom and Sandra Maternus in memory of Sandra's parents. We continue to receive donations for Faux Paul Fair. If you saw some of the images prior to the beginning of the service, you saw the thermometer. The thermometer is rising. We are almost at $7,000. The thermometer goes to the top and $10,000. We have two more weeks to top off the thermometer, perhaps even break the top. Two more weeks collecting donations through November the 1st. Will you consider offering a donation to our Faux Fall Fair in lieu of what you would have spent or provided in past fall fairs? Virtual Sunday School meets again this morning. We are meeting the first and third Sundays of the month. This is our second Sunday of Virtual Sunday School. Begins at 10 a.m. It goes until just prior to the commencement of the worship at 10:30. If you have a child, grandchild, someone that you know who might be interested in participating in virtual Sunday school, will you contact the church office? Today we're beginning a new series of worship themes up to this upcoming season of Advent. We will be looking at characters in the Bible. We will be considering characters who experienced difficult times. And we will examine these characters and some characteristic quality that they demonstrated during their difficult times that God used to mediate or manifest to share God's love and grace. And I think this might be helpful for us during this difficult time of our own to look at Bible characters and see how they acted and how God used them during difficult times. The theme for this morning's service and message is loyalty. We read of God's fidelity, God's faithfulness, God's loyalty to us. We learn about that loyalty demonstrated by Ruth in this morning's message and service. Worship the Lord.
Good morning, everybody. Our first hymn for the day is called Morning Has Broken. It is a wonderful gift that you probably recognize, so please feel free to sing along with Morning Has Broken.
Morning has broken. Good morning to our youngest Christians. I'm Mr. Cruz, and I'm very happy to be with you today. Today, I'd like to share with you a story about loyalty. Well, what is loyalty? Loyalty is being faithful to someone. Now, we all want someone in our lives, someone who is reliable and true, a friendship that you can count on. Someone to be with you through your joys and your bad times as well. And that reminds me of the story of Ruth from the Bible. Now, Ruth makes a decision that will save her family's life. It's a story that will take us all the way from tragedy to hope. What did Ruth decide? Let's find out. Ruth lived in the land of Moab, and she married into a family of a woman named Naomi. Tragically, one day, all of the men in Naomi's family, including Ruth's husband, died, and Ruth was without her husband. One day, Naomi decided that she would return to her family in the land of Judah. That's a part of Israel. And Ruth decided that she would go with Naomi. It was a very brave decision to make. She would be leaving the land that she had grown up in, and she would be going to a strange new place where the people and customs were different. But Ruth saw something in Naomi. She saw something in Naomi's faith and trust in the God of Israel. And she wanted to know more about that faith and trust. And she had it fixed in her mind that she would go with Naomi. Now Naomi tried to stop her and said, "Ruth, you should stay here in Moab and go back to your family where you'll be safe and taken care of." But nothing Naomi could say would discourage Ruth. Ruth said, "Please don't tell me to stay in Moab and go back to my family. Where you go, I will go. Where you live, I will live. Your people will be my people. Your God will be my God. Where you die, I will die. And there I will be buried. With God as my witness, only death shall separate us." Through love and great loyalty, Ruth would not give up on Naomi. And God had a plan for Ruth, and he guided her along the way. Now Ruth, oh, actually, God provided Ruth a job in the fields, and she never gave up. Ruth followed her heart, and doing so, God rewarded her loyalty. She married a godly man named Boaz, and together they had a son, Obed, who God would work through to bring about Jesus coming to this earth. Loyalty and faithfulness in everyday life pleases God. Ruth's love and loyalty towards Naomi led her to risk everything when she made the decision to follow Naomi. And God rewarded Ruth's loyalty and restored her family, giving her hope and a second chance. Would you bow your heads while I say a prayer? Heavenly Father, help us to follow the example of loyalty that Ruth shows us. Help us to never give up and to be loyal in our everyday lives. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
We may trust that God is loyal to us, that God will never abandon us, but God is faithful. We may trust in this as we pray quietly, sharing our joys and concerns with God. trust hearing our prayers. Thank you for the people who are loyal to us, people who are true. Will you help us to be loyal and true as well? Will you help us to nourish the self-respect and the dignity which gives birth to loyalty? Will you help us to remember the commitments, the promises that we have made? We read in the scriptures that you made a promise to send a deliverer, and we read in those same scriptures that you kept your promise, that in Jesus Christ you kept your promise to save us and made a new promise to come again someday and establish your kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. Will you help us to believe that you will be faithful to this promise too, that your loyalty extends not just to our past but to our future? Thank you, God, for bringing us here today to worship you in this way in our own homes. Thank you for the opportunity to remember your faithfulness and to trust in it once more. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ, and we pray the prayer he gave us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. If you feel that God has been true to you and you wish to respond, making a commitment or giving a gift, this is an opportunity to do so. You might place aside a gift to send to the church for the Lord's use at a later time, or text your gift at this point in time during the service. Whatever you are able to give, we may praise God together. God is faithful to us. Provide for us what it is we need for this day.
Thank you.
God, we offer you these gifts, emblematic of our loyalty to you. Will you use them to nourish and nurture our faithfulness, that we might share your faithfulness with your world? Amen. Chapter 1, verses 6 through 18. When she heard in Moab that the Lord had come to the aid of his people by providing food for them, Naomi and her daughters-in-law prepared to return home from there. With her two daughters-in-law, she left the place where she had been living and set out on the road that would take them back to the land of Judah. Then Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, "Go back, each of you, to your mother's home. May the Lord show kindness to you, as you have shown to your dead and to me. May the Lord grant that each of you will find rest in the home of another husband." Then she kissed them, and they wept aloud, and said to her, "We will go back with you to your people." But Naomi said, "Return home, my daughters. Why would you come with me? Am I going to have any more sons who could become your husbands? Return home, my daughters. I am too old to have another husband. Even if I thought there was still hope for me, even if I had a husband tonight and then gave birth to sons, would you wait until they grew up? Would you remain unmarried for them? No, my daughters, it is more bitter for me than for you, because the Lord's hand has gone out against me." At this, they wept again. Then Orpah kissed her mother-in-law goodbye, but Ruth clung to her. "Look," said Naomi, "your sister-in-law is going back to her people and her gods. Go back with her." But Ruth replied, "Don't urge me to leave you or to turn back from you. Where you go, I will go, And where you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord deal with me, be it ever so severely, if anything but death separates you and me. When Naomi realized that Ruth was determined to go with her, she stopped urging her. One Christian author has observed and asked the following. When you go to a play or a movie or watch a TV show that contains a story that you have never seen or heard before, what is the first question that comes to your mind when an actor or actress appears on stage or screen? This Christian author went on to suppose, writing, "I believe the first question that we ask when we see an actor or actress appear on the screen for the first time is, what kind of character is this? Is this a good character or a bad character?" In the old Westerns, we were given hints as to the good characters and the bad characters. The good characters wore white hats, and the bad characters wore black hats. But we ask the question, this author goes on to say, what kind of character is this? Because character is important to us. It's been said that God's primary interest is in our character, because through our character, we experience God's salvation. Someone else has said, beware of your thoughts, because your thoughts influence your actions. Your actions influence your habits. Your habits influence your character, and your character shapes your destiny. It's been supposed that the whole purpose of life is to develop a character shaped around loving God above all things. Well, if this is true, then character is important. And I'm thinking that it might be helpful for us to look at certain qualities. People are very complicated, I think. We are a mix of many motives and influences. There are days when we help and there are days when we harm. But still, we want to speak of people's character. It comes natural to us, and I think it can be helpful. So I want to look at characters. Character traits and qualities. Characters in the Bible who, like us, today, faced difficult times, and examine what these characters did, how they acted, what quality or trait they demonstrated, through which, and I think this is especially important, through which God's grace and love were revealed. I'd like to do that for the next few weeks leading up. In each case, we will see something a character did or demonstrated that enabled God's grace to be made real, to manifest itself. And today, we start with Ruth. If you are not familiar with the story of Ruth, I encourage you to read it. It is found in the Old Testament and is told in only 4 chapters. Kevin did a very nice job reviewing it in his message for our youngest Christians. But in case you missed his review, Ruth is a Moabite woman, that is, a non-Jew, who marries a Jewish man. Tragically, her husband passes away, leaving her a widow at a young age. Strikingly, and central to the story, her father-in-law and a brother-in-law also pass away, leaving not only Ruth a widow, but also her mother-in-law, Naomi, and her sister-in-law, Orpah, widows too. And our scripture reading today tells how the three women began a journey together back to Naomi's home in Judah, more specifically, Bethlehem. We read how Naomi urged her two daughters-in-law, Ruth and Orpah, to remain behind in Moab, to return to their homes of origin, to stay in their home country. We heard that Orpah eventually followed Naomi's urging, but Ruth did not. Paradoxically, Ruth was disobedient, but her disobedience is considered an act of loyalty. Her loyalty to Naomi eventually resulted in their story having a very happy ending. They returned to Bethlehem together. There Ruth, along with Naomi's help, met a man named Boaz. Boaz and Ruth married and were blessed with a son named Obed. Obed grows up to be the grandfather of Israel's greatest king, David. And because David was an ancestor of Jesus, Ruth is also an ancestor to Jesus. In fact, the Gospel of Matthew lists Ruth in Jesus' genealogy. She shows up on Ancestry.com in Jesus' lineage. So, I think it can be fairly said that Jesus Christ came into our world in the manner that he did, partly because of Ruth's loyalty to Naomi. Her loyalty enabled God's saving grace to manifest itself in a particular way, through the house and lineage of King David, and finally, through our blessed Lord. Someone has said, "I look for 3 things in a friend. First, I look for honesty. Will they tell me the truth? Second, I look for respect. Will they treat me with respect? Third, I look for loyalty. Will they be loyal friends?" I think those priorities are very helpful. But it raises the question, what really is loyalty? We might say loyalty is commitment. Resolute, steadfast commitment. And that is, I think, one of the definitions of loyalty. But it's also said that loyalty is dying out. Frederick Reichel is a New York Times best-selling author whose area of expertise is in the business world, specifically with regards to loyalty to businesses. And This is what he wrote. Loyalty is dead, the experts proclaim, and the statistics bear them out. On average, U.S. corporations now lose half their customers in 5 years, half their employees in four, and half their investors in less than one. We seem to face a future in which the only business relationships will be opportunistic transactions between virtual strangers. As I understand that, he's saying that loyalty is dying, if not dead, in our business relationships. Do you think that's true? If it is loyalty dead in our other relationships as well? Loyalty can be elusive in terms of understanding because loyalty is perhaps a situational thing. Where do my commitments lie? Have you ever experienced conflicted loyalties? Been through a divorce or in a family that's experienced divorce and heard someone say, "I hope I won't have to choose someone." Mark Twain once said, "Loyalty to the country always, loyalty to the government where it deserves it." That's not a political statement on my part. Rather, it is an attempt to communicate the nuances around the issue of loyalty. Where do my loyalties lie? Who am I loyal to? What do you think Mark Twain meant by that? Does commitment or loyalty mean that we always agree, always accept, always obey, that we never disagree, never confront, never differ with the person to whom we are loyal? Is that what loyalty is? In our story, it is important to note that of the two daughters-in-law, Orpah is the one who actually obeyed Naomi by leaving her. Ruth is lauded, and rightfully so, for her loyalty, but as has already been mentioned, she disobeyed Naomi by staying with her. Can that mean that loyalty sometimes means disobedience? What about our loyalty to God? When Jesus says the most important thing in life is to love God above all, with all of our heart and soul and mind and strength, what does that mean for our loyalty? Though she disobeyed Naomi, she disobeyed out of love. The Hebrew word, sometimes translated loyalty, is hesed. H-E-S-E-D. It's a word that appears frequently in the Old Testament. It's sometimes translated loyalty. Sometimes it's translated faithfulness, fidelity, loving kindness. It is the word, scholars tell us, used in the Old Testament to most describe God's relationship to us, to God's world. God is faithful, loving, loyal to us. Loyalty means I refuse to abandon. This is another definition of the word, and it is a most powerful, powerful reality. Studies done, a attempting to explain why soldiers will risk their lives in battle, have concluded that loyalty played an important part. Soldiers will put aside their basic drive for self-preservation and put their lives at risk willingly out of loyalty. Loyalty to their country and loyalty to their fellow soldiers. I watched a documentary recently. I believe it was filmed in Japan, focusing on a battle that took place in World War II in Burma in India called the Battle of Imphal. It was a terrible defeat for the Japanese. Japanese soldiers marched 300 miles through jungle. They had no supplies. They were counting on capturing British supplies, but they were not able to do that. And so, out of the 50,000 soldiers that survived the battle, they had to retreat only to be blocked by the monsoons in a swollen river, the Chindwin River. More soldiers died retreating from that battle. Over 30,000 died in retreat. This Japanese program interviewed Japanese soldiers surviving. And I remember one 95-year-old man who said, every day I look at the pictures of my friends that I lost. I treat them as if they are alive. I pray for them. This is the strength of loyalty. It is an expression of love. No greater love has man than this, that he laid down his life for another. The story of Ruth demonstrates the power of loyalty to overcome great personal loss and grief and devastation. Ruth's loyalty to Naomi and Naomi's loyalty towards Ruth enabled these women, so vulnerable, there was no system providing for unmarried women at that time to care for them. Their loyalty enabled these women to survive and even succeed in their life back in Bethlehem. As I said, Ruth marries, has a son, and the story ends in great joy with Naomi bouncing her grandson on her knee. It makes me ask the question, or I want to ask the question, what part does loyalty play in our lives today in our difficult world? A world that is unsettled by natural disasters, hurricane and fires, a world that is torn apart by riots and unrest in cities, a world that is falling apart, it seems, around our ears with political vitriol and hatred expressed in public. And of course, this pandemic and all that it means for our lives. Separated by physical differences, anxious about our health and the future, experiencing these natural disasters, caught up in this tumultuous political election. What or who are we really loyal to? How can we be loyal to one another today? How can we be loyal to our country? How can we be loyal to our community? How can we be loyal to God? What about loyalty to each other in our communities of faith? Someone has said that loyalty springs forth within the human soul from self-respect and dignity. I believe myself to be a loyal person. What does that mean in my relationship? relationships. If I respect myself, can I respect others by being faithful to them? The story is told of a father and his young son who went to a kite flying festival. The young boy had never flown a kite before, but his father bought him a colorful kite with a roller wrapped around it, a long piece of string, twine, thread. And the boy, after a few attempts, succeeded in getting his kite off the ground, and soon it was soaring high in the air. The boy smiled, watching his kite fly so high with all the other kites in the air. And after a while, the boy turned to his father and he said, "It seems the thread is holding the kite down. Flying higher. Maybe if we cut the string, it will be free and we'll go on flying even higher. Can we cut it, Dad?" His father was a wise father. He knew the answer to the question, but he also knew that his son would learn more from doing than hearing. So the father said yes, took out a pocket knife, and cut the string. The kite started to go higher and higher, and that made the boy very happy. But as the boy watched the kite high in the sky, he noticed that slowly, after a while, the kite started to come down. And soon it was lower than where it had been when they cut the string. And then it fell lower and lower and lower. It just was tossed and turned, buffeted by the wind, until he saw it fall down on the terrace of a building in the distance. The boy was surprised and a little sad. He had cut the string so it could fly high. He asked, "Father, I thought after cutting the thread, the kite would be free. Why did it fall down?" And the father explained, "Son, at the height of life, we sometimes think strings tie us down. But the truth is, the string on that kite was helping the kite fly. By holding it in place when the wind died down. And when we cut the thread, the kite fell down because we couldn't support it anymore." That is what I think loyalty is. It is why it is the word the Old Testament uses to describe God's relationship more to us. It is the golden thread through which we really support one another. Loyalty.
Part Planet Suite. It's from
remember the scriptures proclaiming your loyalty to us, even when we are disloyal to you and one another. Will you help us to remember this day that you will never abandon us, that you will always walk by our side, you will always prompt us from behind, you will always lead us towards your kingdom.